Good afternoon, everyone. I would like to start my presentation, which is on inclusive and sustainable urban development opportunities. We'll be focusing on a little bit of Karnataka and also the overall issues. Now, if you consider the scope of inclusive and sustainable urban development, there are many different issues, many different topics, many different sectors that comes into. And all these things which comes from land, legislation, governance, planning, economy, basic services, housing, risk reduction, and also research and capacity building of the urban local bodies and municipal authorities. This, all this dimension, all this gamut is actually transformed and actually focuses or actually built in to be the sustainable urban development that we are all focusing on, we are all trying to achieve in our country. In my presentation, I try to touch upon some of these issues. It is not possible among this time to focus all of this, but all these pertinent issues is relevant when we are talking about sustainability and inclusiveness. Now to start with, which is our process of our development, our master planning and development process, city planning process, let's take an example, or let's take cases where we can see how we are growing traditionally in our country. This is one of the process where Delhi Master Plan, which is one of the most or one of the planned cities in our country, it started from the 50s. But we can see there are some of the areas where traditionally our master planning process or our development process fails to focus on. The 62 master plan, which was culminated in 81. But after that, there was almost a decade gap that has been evolved, and then we have started another master plan in 1990. And this master planning process, we are still following, but it's so much time consuming, so much energy that is required. And at the end, in implementation, it becomes like a very difficult process to implement all those vision that looks very good on paper, on document, and on the report. So what I will focus that whether we can have an alternative approaches or something which can be infused into this master planning or traditional planning and development process, and we can achieve inclusive and sustainable urban growth. Now let's take an example. This is one of the very best planned cities that we have, Noida. It looks very precious, it looks very beautiful, it is all colorful, it's all very much sectoral plan with all the land uses, with broad roads, which is sectioned as long as 60 meter wide sometime. And this is all segregated sectoral plan that we are still following. Many of the cities are still doing these kinds of planning processes. Now, in reality, what we see is this. Let's take a focus of one of the sectors. This is around the Atta or sector 18. And you can see all the things that was not initially planned when we have proposed this beautiful master plan, which looks so elegant, so nice on paper. But we have, and at the result, we got this all these kinds of results that we are not focused on or we're not anticipating. I can culminate into three groups. It's like all infrastructure insufficiency and this urban informality. Informality in terms of economy, informality in terms of shelter, in terms of settlement, informality in terms of transportation. All those urban informality we can see in a beautiful proposed master plan, and also not utilization of the resources that we are already having. We have this plan, but nobody is using it. Now we need to understand and we need to question as a urban planner ourselves why, after preparing this beautiful master plan, which is as we have seen in the earlier session, there was green field and brown field, lots of talks have happened. This is one of the green field development which is being planned from the scratch, but yet we got these kinds of results. Now we need to understand or we need to question or we need to plan why this has happened and how we can prevent this to happen and then make SCTs more inclusive, more sustainable. Now, when we plan cities, one of the very key issues that we often forget is that this, as we are talking about greenfield and brownfield development, this economic, social, and cultural opportunities that cities create, it's a gamut of area which creates the economic and social opportunities. The opportunities which is not there in rural area. So by natural tendency, people will come and flow into your city system, whether it is a greenfield, whether it is a brownfield. This all these leisure will come into your cities from around the cities. It may be local, it may be regional, it may be national. But if we are talking about this as a labor industry, as a labor market pooling inside of your city agglomeration process, we also need to consider these laborers or these people as a human capital, capital who can grow, who can help or who can develop our cities to be more sustainable. We need to respect them and we need to make utilization of this human process or human capitals into better development and better process or better growth of our cities. So we make utilization of these people, make utilization of this human capital that is flowing or coming into your cities. So this is one of the key issues that we always focus or we have also highlighted during the process is this migration. Now migration is not bad. It is useful. It is needed. But it depends migration of where. The cities that we have planned actually invited or migrated people into this informal sectors. So informal sector means the sectors which is low economic productivity. Now people who has migrated to city like Noida, Gurgaon or other planned cities mostly belong to the of lower economic productive sectors rather than high economic productive sector like Bengaluru, one of the key examples where people coming all over the country, all over the, even from international migration is happening and creating this city to be more developed like an urban village which has a place not only in India but at the globe. So we require these kinds of migration but in places where we have this high economic productive sector can be utilized. So this is a plan which, or this is a process which we have, which we can or we can do. And in this case, Noida, what they have opted for is a kind of planned informal sector migration, kind of a responsibility which urban planners may have not visualized at that moment when we have planned for or they have planned for. So they have planned this beautiful sector-wise development, which means have a small residential land uses with commercial and industrial and commercial places and green areas. But look at this, and there is one MRTA system that runs from somewhere from here, and now it's created a nightmare for urban mobility planner. How can we get all these people from here to here? It takes almost half an hour to walk from this node to that node. And it creates a terrific trouble for the urban planner to develop something called transit-oriented development, where this density, transit, and land use relationship can be understood. So you have this evenly distributed density throughout the city, and which creates these kinds of all urban informality that flows into here or filling the gap, because you need this door-to-door transportation from my home to my office place to my school, and I want to go there for without much kind of harassment, without much kind of time consuming. So those kinds of necessity, those kinds of demand created those informal sector influence into the city system. So in the development process, in the master planning and development process, what we are talking about, we forgot these kinds of human interaction, these kinds of public participation or public interaction with city space. At the end of the day, we are all human beings and we have certain kinds of interaction with our all the spaces. We need market, we need schools, we need small loitering areas. And that is too, also in a very small amount of price that we need to make. For example, the consumable items like food and all those things. We need our potatoes to be 20 rupees kg. We need our rice to be certain amounts of money. But who will get those things to the city? That the notion it needs to be integrated into this master planning process, which is presently is not that much visible in our master planning process. So it always creates these kinds of informality in whether it is a greenfield development or new development or a development which is a development which we call urban regeneration or urban renewal, which are infilling the existing development process. So how to get rid of this kinds of thing, this kinds of plant disaster that we may often call, and how we can evolve to be a better city system or a better sustainable and inclusive city system that always we talk about. One of the things is that this very picture, that we cannot have another master plan and wait for another 50 years for this mess to be rectified. This looks like a very normal picture, but when I say this is not actually one picture, these are the two pictures which is being merged together and created in one. On the left side, it is taken from Dharavi, our own Dharavi slum area in Mumbai, and on the right side, it's from a narrow alley of Tokyo. So you can see two distinctly socio-economic areas, socio-economic spatial areas has been integrated into, and if you see these kinds of alley, it's almost identical both in Dharavi and also in Tokyo. But if this is a slum, why not this one, or the other way around? If this is not a slum, why this is a slum? So in terms of density, in terms of land use, in terms of proportion, it's all the same. Two identical cities of same scenario, but one is designated as a slum, another is not. Now if we can identify a little bit of technical term what Tokyo has in terms of sustainability, probably everything this small area will have. They have a good trade and services, they have a good network of goods and services, they have beautiful public transit system, they have the best urban utilities and services, economic opportunities, everybody has their own job, own livability. They have the human capital, social capital, cosmopolitan city, environmental standards, and equitable almost. So it makes a sustainable, it makes an inclusive. But if we talk about Dharavi, probably some of the things are there. If you go there, there are some of the things will there, but some of the things probably missing. Leave apart this notion of slum, think about only the spatial planning, the spatial distribution of the city itself. So probably we can remove some of these red features, probably we can also have one urban regenerated or urban area which is almost as good as Dharavi, as Tokyo itself. So these are the new kinds of regenerative city planning process that we need to integrate it into our traditional master planning process. So then we can probably achieve a much more sustainable and inclusive urban development process rather than the tradition. Look at this density. It's almost have a density of around 2,000 persons per square per hectare or something, which is almost identical density that we are talking about. Beautiful for the public transit to function. So all these cities, this has these beautiful collector roads, which connect somewhere here, and then the public transit system can run away. They have some green spaces, probably something more interventions, they can achieve more green spaces. And if you can see of these, all the urban systems, all our necessity, all our needs, or our interaction with the market, or our interaction with the life, for example, shops, schools, and all those household industries, that is also there within this city system itself. So it is probably a better manifestation of a sustainable and inclusive growth or inclusive urban development process rather than what we are creating in Noida. And all this household industries that we have. For example, in Taiwan, if you see, 30% of their electronic export come from household industry, and which employ almost 70% of their workforces. So that kind of household industry you can come across within this city itself. Bengaluru is one of the IT hub of India. It has that kinds of small potential if you can consider those kinds of urban and regional economic scenarios. This is one of the greatest example of urban regeneration, where we divide off the roads and created this beautiful nala, a beautiful lane of water bodies. And that creates a space for urban design, space for plazas, parks, space for human interaction with city life itself. Now, yesterday we were coming from the road and we went into the ISC campus. From the road itself and the campus was so green, you can feel that there is a change of your microclimate. Your temperature become much lower than you are probably getting outside on the road. So these small kinds of intervention in our city life itself, in our cities, in our development, in the spatial planning process, that can create this city more livable, more viable, and our standard of living, not only the standard, the quality of life or the livability that we are focusing on so much, that can be enhanced. And this is also supported by this public transit system that was very much necessity in our case. Now take a look at how we can move forward. Whenever this planning process, we only focuses on this small city. So whenever we have a city, it's almost like only the city itself and nothing else. But the thing is that the city never walks alone. It's a maze of this network. If you consider this Karnataka, almost 30 cities that we can identify, and there are a maze of network of economics, network of social, network of cultural connectivity. This network needs to be identified. It doesn't matter whether you plan for this one or plan for that one. Even for the cities outside where you can expect some kinds of influence in your cities, like cities in Tamil Nadu. So take those kinds of ideas, this regional perspective into your process, so that you can identify the city's future trend. Otherwise it would not be, whether it is a greenfield development or it's an urban regeneration process, it would not create that kind of sustainable, livable, and healthy cities that we always focus on. Now, this is what the recent focus of the development process of Karnataka. This is one of the two aspects. One is this this transit corridor that is focusing on hugely aimed or hugely high process or high project that in terms, and also the smart city. Now, when we are talking about these kinds of transit-oriented networking, there are lots of consequences which will affect into the ground reality. Whenever we have designed these kinds of transit network, there will be more consequences on the small cities in and around these transit routes. There will be more consequences on the big cities in and around this transit route. So, all this economic and social planning and planning that happens, that take place in this economic and social gamut, has an influence in our city planning process. So we need to take care or take consideration of these kinds of economic and social and big policies that the government takes on. So in the master planning process or then the development process, even if it doesn't matter if it is a corporation or municipality or urban local body, the effect of these kinds of development process needs to be understood and needs to be anticipated in advance so that we can plan for the what are the aftermath of these kinds of development process will take place. Now, how we can go in the future is for one of the key issues that always have been focuses on is a need for sustainable governance for a sustainable urban future. Now, one thing that Karnataka, well, because we are talking about urbanization not only of Bengaluru or Mangalore or some of the big cities, we are talking about the urbanization process of the whole Karnataka as itself. So there needs to be a state level intervention somewhere it's required for you or for any other cities or any other states that we're talking about to proceed on. It may be an independent or it may be the government authority, but the state level intervention which will take place is regional identification, networking, and the regional linkages of different cities. And then probably the city can have these all development authorities, and then again the municipality and the urban local body can take place or take shape of this local planning process. So there has to have some kinds of intervention at the state level to identify the regional process of city planning. Another one aspect that was very much discussed in the earlier session is the financing. For example, this transit route that is getting financed, probably it's from METI. So, I'm just concluding. So this sustainable financing, how you will get financing of your city process itself, it needs to be identified. Before you plan or vision or in a dream about your city planning process, this financing needs to be identified. So at the end, SMART, which we all are trying to have, it can be have, but it needs to be have these kinds of properties, like it's specific, measurable, attainable, relevant, and it's time-based. So this, the fast-growing city planning or development process, it has to have a very fast planning mode. Master planning process, which takes 30, 40 years, may not be a good idea to proceed on. And we also need to have these kinds of inclusiveness, which will have the participation and the welfare and social safety of this. So at the last, what I would like to conclude by saying that, remember these kinds of things like density land use plan for effective effective public transit, which discourage these private vehicles into your cities, and then linkages of spatial planning to economic, social, and cultural and ecological policies. And next is the fast city planning process, and engage experts like us or others to have a rightful knowledge to implement the city planning process. Thank you.